Good morning and happy Easter to everyone. It's lovely to see you here. A warm welcome to St. Andrew's on this most special of days. I've seen a number of sort of baskets and hats and the odd pair of bunny ears around as well. But we meet today to celebrate our risen and reigning Lord Jesus. And it is a delight to see so many folks here this morning. If you're joining us online, happy Easter to you, and we hope that you're having a wonderful day celebrating with others on this special occasion. And we're delighted you can join us as we meet here. All around the world, Christians greet one another on this morning in the same way and with the same words. So shall we stand together at the beginning of our service and use the little response that you will see on the screen? No, you won't see it on the screen, but hopefully most of you know it. It's very easy. It goes, Alleluia, Christ is risen. I say that bit. And then you respond, He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Oh, you see, you do know it. Okay. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah indeed. Many, many years before Jesus even stepped foot on the earth, the psalmist, King David, said these words, Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest secure, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead, nor will you let your Holy One see decay. You made known to me the path of life. You fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. David knew what he was talking about, because he was talking about the day when we would see the risen Lord and he would bring to us the joy of Easter morning. Shall we stand and sing together?
Oh,
Do please take a seat. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus brings with it so many good things. We have so many lovely things to be able to celebrate this Easter morning. Some of those come in this sort of shape. And around the church, you will find a number of small ones and a few big ones. So, when I say go, when I say go. You've got to find as many of these as you can. There is something inside all of them, but you can come to the front and we will open them up together, okay? Okay, you got it? Find them, bring them, and then we'll open them. Okay, 3, 2, 1, go! I think there are some upstairs as well. I'm looking at Katie. Are there some upstairs, Katie? There are some upstairs as well. Now, if you manage to find a big one, I need to make sure that comes to the front. Oh, my goodness, they're all going. Right, okay. Okay, what we found, we found. Let's come back to the front. And especially if you've got one of my nice big eggs. Okay, brilliant. Have you managed to find some? You've managed to find one? Right. You've got one. Excellent. Well done. You hold on to that. Oh, hello. That one's open already. Okay, if you've got them, come back here. Now, can I count up and see how many big eggs we've got? Hold up a big egg if you've got one. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's coming. Excellent. Now, do you want, if you've got a little egg, open that up now for me, okay? And you can tell me what's inside. What's inside? More eggs, okay. Yes, you've got chocolate inside. Now, if you've got little eggs, they're for you. You can take those back to your seats. In fact, if you've got little eggs but haven't got a big egg, you take those back to your seat now and you can go and suck on your chocolate. And if you've got a big egg, stay here. Yep, you take those back. Yep, don't worry, you can take that back to your seat. You've got one of each. You can suck on the little eggs later and then the big eggs are for now. Brilliant. So what I've got here are the big eggs. Now, these are really special. So inside the others, that's chocolate. And we all like chocolate, don't we? Chocolate's great. Chocolate's fun. Chocolate tastes nice. And we like to think that Easter brings us lots of good things because of the chocolate. But in the big eggs, there is something even more special. So I'm going to open up some of these big eggs. What's in this one? Do you want to find out? There we go. Now, we're going to read out. In each of these eggs, we have got a verse from the Bible that is going to be able to tell us one of the very special things that Easter brings to us. Why don't you can be my expert reader, if this is on. Are we on? Brilliant.
In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade.
Easter morning brings us hope, hope that will never perish, hope that will never spoil, hope that will never fade. a solid, firm future. That's a wonderful thing that Easter brings, because Jesus is not dead.
In Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come.
Have we got that one? Easter brings not just hope, it brings transformation. It changes us. Just as Jesus was changed from the mortal body that could die to one that was resurrected and perfect for all eternity, so Easter promises to those who trust in Jesus transformation. Here's another one. Where are you? Hello. Do you want to open this? Do you want to find out what's inside?
He is not here. He has risen, just as he said.
He is not here. He is risen. Just as he said, Easter, first and foremost, brings us a living Lord. A living Lord. Jesus is not dead. He is alive today and he is alive forever. We do not meet here to remember someone from the past. We meet here to remember that Jesus is alive today. One more. Do you want to give it a... Tell you what. You give that one a squeeze, see whether you can get it out. Give it a big squeeze. Boom. There we go. Brilliant. Thanks.
Dad, more than that, was raised to dead and is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us.
Jesus Christ, who died and more than that, was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. We have someone who prays for us at the right hand of God today. Jesus pleads the cross day after day at the throne of heaven. One more. Do you want to give it a squeeze? See if you can get it out. Give it up. Yeah, go on. Oh, hello. There you go. Good technique. There we go.
He gives us the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ.
There's the big one, isn't it? He gives us the victory through the Lord Jesus Christ. We have death feels like the one that will always beat us, doesn't it? In the end, it feels like it'll always beat us. But Jesus gives us the victory. Thank you so much to my team up here. Brilliant work. You can take those back, and if you go and take a seat. Why don't we turn some of those things into a word of prayer before we go on? We want to say thank you, don't we, to God for those great things that he has given to us. So let's pray before we sing again. Heavenly Father, we thank you that because of Easter, we have a living Lord. We thank you that Jesus is on the throne of heaven now and that he lives for us. And he lives to pray for us. He lives to appeal for us the glories of the cross, the victory of the cross. We thank you that we are not a defeated people. We thank you that death does not have the last word in this world. We thank you that Jesus does and that he reigns and that he has won. And we thank you that brings us a hope, a living hope. And we pray that you would keep that hope burning bright in our minds as we remember that all that perishes and spoils and fades around us is not the last thing that we will see, that we have a hope that is eternal. And we thank you that in that you promise to change us. Father, we are conscious so often of our failings, of our weakness, of our frailty, but we thank you that that is not our future. We thank you that there is transformation for all who trust in the Lord Jesus, and it is so because of Easter Day. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to sing. I've got some more eggs up here. These don't have chocolate in them, but they do have sort of noisy things in them. And it would be great if we could get a few people up here to come and shake these and make a good loud noise. Easter isn't just good news for us; it's good news for everyone, young and old. Katie, brilliant, thank you. It's good news for everyone, young and old. And it's news that we want to tell. Do you remember how Mary, when she met the Lord Jesus at the empty tomb, what was the first thing that she did? She went and told. When Jesus came and spoke to his disciples on that first night, the first thing he said was, "I am here, now go." We want to be those who tell everyone that Jesus is alive. Got a few more members of the band coming up later. Here we go. Come on, guys. Brilliant. Let's stand and sing together. Tell them, tell them, tell everybody. Tell them the stone's been rolled away.
It might be worth saying that we repeat the first verse, but twice as fast. So just a warning, okay? Hold on to your skirts.
Well done. Do give Katie back her eggs. And do take a seat if you haven't already. The good news of Easter really is for everyone. It is for young and old. It is for those of us who have been Christians for many years. And it is for the youngest child. And over the course of these last couple of weeks, some of our children have been reading and rereading the Easter story to try to just take in everything that it has. So we're going to read the passage that they've been reading this morning. It's from John chapter 20. You can turn it up in your Bibles. John chapter 20. And I forgot to check a page number, so I think it's about 1089. You might want to have that close by. You might even want to read along, but don't miss what's going on the screen, because our children are going to read John chapter 20 for us. They've even tried to illustrate it for us as well. And when we've heard it being read, then Paul is going to come and help us to understand and to take it in for ourselves.
John chapter 19, verse 41, to chapter 20, verse 1 to 9.
At the place where Jesus was crucified,
there was a garden.
And in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. because it was the Jewish day of preparation and since the tomb was nearby.
That made Jesus birth early on the first day of the week.
While it was still dark,
Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance.
So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said,
"They have taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they have took him."
So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb.
Both were running. The other disciple outran Peter and got to the tomb first. He bent over and looked at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in.
So Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight to the tomb.
He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head.
The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen.
Finally, the other disciples, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside.
He saw and believed.
They still did not understand from scriptures that Jesus had to rise from the dead.
Marvellous, marvellous. What wonderful reading, everybody. Thank you for putting that together. Let me just get this table. What are we expecting on an Easter Sunday? I've brought a few things from home to try and think through some of the things we expect to happen. So any youngsters, what do we expect to find in this box? What do we expect? Sophie? An Easter egg. Very, very good. I think we expect to find an Easter egg. What about in here? What do we expect to find in here? Crisps, absolutely. Absolutely, we expect to find crisps. And what about in here? Maybe some from another generation. What do we expect? Biscuits! Well shouted out, Lily Rob. Fantastic. But the funny thing is, when you start to open stuff up, you can only find out what's really in there when you open it up and have a look for yourself. And when we open these... How did you get into this? They do make them harder, don't they? When you start opening things up, sometimes you get things that you're not quite expecting. Especially if you're 5 years old and sat on the front row and wondering why your dad's nicked one of your teddies. And it's the same with all kinds of things. You expect one thing, but you end up with something completely different. Now, biscuits. Here's something that I don't think we would be too happy about getting. One thing I have learned is don't keep lettuce in a biscuit tin overnight. It doesn't come out the most attractive. But would we be happy about this? Would we be happy with finding these things? Would we be happy with finding a teddy bear instead of chocolate? Maybe not. Would we be happy with finding pennies instead of crisps? I guess it depends how much the pennies are worth, isn't it? Is it enough to buy the crisps? Would anybody be happy finding wilted lettuce instead of biscuits? No, we wouldn't be, would we? That wouldn't be the way we'd want to do it. Well, there are a lot of different expectations about Easter. But on that very first Easter, when Jesus' friends came to visit the tomb, it was a very unexpected day. See, they'd seen Jesus die on Good Friday. They'd seen him be buried in a tomb. So imagine what it's like if you're Mary Magdalene that very first Easter morning. It's dark. It's cold still. It's quiet. The birds haven't woken up yet. And you're approaching the garden where Jesus' body has been laid. What do you expect to find? A grave?
a tomb, a body wrapped in cloth. What does Mary find? Verse 1 of our passage. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been rolled away. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put his body, where they've put him." It's a real shock. This is not what she was expecting. And when we read the Bible, this isn't what we would expect either. We've just read about Good Friday. We've just read about Jesus dying on the cross to pay for the sins of the world. What are we expecting to come next? I think some sort of reaction, some sort of response, maybe a memorial to Jesus, maybe sharing words and memories of Jesus. Frankly, I think we could expect the voice of God from the sky saying something about what Jesus has just done. But we don't hear anything. We don't even hear about the Passover. If this were a great victory of, like, a sports team, you would expect, you know, a panel of experts, maybe an interview with a manager or a player. If this were on the news, if we turned on the news and we heard the great news, the greatest news, that the whole world had been saved by Jesus on the cross, what would we expect? Maybe, I don't know, a statement from the king? But we don't get any of that. Why? Why don't we get any reactions? Because this true story of the Bible is not finished yet. It's not finished yet. Mary Magdalene, she runs to Peter and John. And what do Peter and John do when they hear verse 3? It says, "So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first." He ran there, got there first because they were running as fast as they could. They're not jogging, they're not walking, they're not bimbling along. They are running as fast as they can. I've seen a lot of running around here this morning. It's amazing what chocolate will do to motivate the legs, isn't it? Lots of people in my family run either for exercise or for play or simply just to get to church on time. Personally, I think I'd have to be chased by a lion. But why are Peter and John running? They're running because this is the most urgent thing in their lives. This is the most important news they've ever got. And they want to go and see for themselves. They want to see what they've been told by Mary. And what do they see? Verse 5. "He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen." They go inside, and the tomb is empty. They look around. It is empty. All they find is some grave clothes, very neatly laid in place. I don't know about you, sometimes in our house when we play hide and seek, particularly if you're bigger than the children, one of the best ways to hide is find a corner and just throw a blanket over yourself. There's no hiding in these folded grave clothes. They're neatly folded, totally different to the way it was with Lazarus, where he came out still wearing them. This tomb is empty. Why is this tomb empty? Because Jesus is alive. Christ is risen. And this empty tomb, is the sign that we've all been waiting for in John. In John's book, John's account of Jesus' life, this is the ultimate proof we've been waiting for. Now, Sunday Club, Climbers and Explorers, you've been looking at some signs, haven't you? Yeah? Some of the signs of John. What did Jesus turn water into? Go on, Noah, shout. Wine! Absolutely. And what did Jesus do with a couple of fish and 5 small barley loaves? Who did he feed? 5,000, exactly. You've been looking at these signs. You've been looking at the sign of raising Lazarus from the dead. Well, the whole of John's book is one big sign. It's filled with lots of little signs, but it's one big sign. Okay, right at the beginning of Jesus' ministry, he went to the temple in Jerusalem. And there, he found tables with people exchanging money. He found people selling animals to be taken to the temple. He found corruption. Where there was supposed to be nothing but worship of the Lord God, he found crooked merchants trying to rid people of their money. So he made a whip out of cords, and he went round and he drove them all out. And they said, "What right have you got to do this?" Their literal words were, "What sign can you give us to prove your authority to do this?" And Jesus responded, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." And the temple he was talking about was his own body. "Destroy this body, and I will raise it again in 3 days." Well, here we are. It is Easter Sunday. It is the third day. And the tomb is empty. Jesus Christ is risen. That was the sign for the whole of the world. That was the sign for John stood in that empty tomb. And what does he make of it? Verse 8. "Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first," that's John, "also went inside. He saw and believed." He saw and believed. And that is the sign for all of us this Easter, to see and believe. But hang on, how can we see what John saw? How can we believe as John believed? Well, before we had a little look at some unexpected stuff, and I'll ask if the camera guys can zoom in a little bit so we can see these. What does it say on the front of this egg box? Eleanor? Incredible egg, that bit though. What does that bit say? Teddy. It says Teddy. It was written there all along. What does it say on our Pringles tin? Pennies. We should have known it all along. What about our biscuit tin? It was written there all along. If we'd only taken a moment to look, we'd have realized what was in there. Verse 9 of our passage says this. "They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead." How can we see the signs of John? How can we see the sign of the empty tomb? We can read it in Scripture. And what are all these signs for? John finishes his book. He finishes his account of Jesus' life. In the final chapter come these words: "Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." The empty tomb is there to help us believe in Jesus Christ, to believe in his death on the cross to pay for our sins, to believe that he is the one who delivers on what he has promised. And what he has promised is eternal life. Not just eternal in length, but eternal in scale. This is life to the full. And the one who promises you and me life to the full is the one who has defeated death. He has beaten death. Death couldn't hold on to him. He has blasted away straight through that tomb, straight through death and into life. And that is the life he offers to us. So this Easter, whatever we come with our expectations, let us look to his word and see the great signs that give us faith in Jesus and eternal life in his name. Amen.
We want to pray that not only would we look at the witness of those who first saw and believed, but that we would be those who enable others to see the Lord Jesus for who he is and to believe. We're going to spend a bit of time in prayer now, and we're going to be praying not just for ourselves as we've been praying all morning, we're going to be praying for those around us in the world. And so the first picture is on the screen. Some of you will know where that place is. I won't ask you to guess, but it's in West Africa. And it's a place where one of our mission partners lives and seeks to make the Lord Jesus known in a country that is an Islamic country where that is the dominant faith there, religion. Of course, we have mission partners in all different parts of the world, and many of those work is in Islamic areas and in other areas of the world where Jesus is not known. What would it be good to pray that they would see in West Africa and where Lydia is working, and in Iran where so many of our friends here have come from? What would it be good that we would pray that they would see? Well, how about this? We had that on the... How about we pray that they would know that we have a living Lord, not one that has been written about in books in history, but one who is alive today. Should we do that? Should we pray for them? Heavenly Father, we thank you that the Lord Jesus is not in the grave, that he has risen just as he says. And so we pray for that part of West Africa, amongst the Moors of West Africa. We pray for the country of Iran, where so many here have friends and family. We pray for the country where Lydia is working elsewhere in Africa. We pray for those who are seeking to proclaim Jesus and learn to do that and be prepared to do that through Bunda Bible College in Tanzania. Father, we thank you that the Lord Jesus is alive, that he is living, and we pray that those in that country would see that he has a claim on their lives today, that it is to him that we bow the knee. Amen. How about this picture? Now, can somebody who has been watching the news this week tell me where that is? Anybody, any children know where that is? So it's a picture that we've seen a lot on our news. Do you know where it is? It's Gaza. That's exactly right. All the way through the week, we have seen pictures of food drops over Gaza. A place that feels abandoned by so much of the world. What do we want to pray for people in Gaza, and indeed for those in Israel as well, where they feel that they are isolated? Wouldn't it be a great thing to pray that they would know that we have someone who intercedes for us, someone at the right hand of the Father who will pray for us, that we are not on our own? Not just that we would get provided with food aid, but that we would be provided with the aid that we all need to know the cross of the Lord Jesus and his saving work. Jesus lives to pray. Should we pray that they would know that? Heavenly Father, we do pray for Gaza, for Israel, for everywhere in this world that is torn about by conflict and feels as though they have been abandoned. And we pray that they would know that because Jesus is alive, you have not abandoned them, that there is one who sits at the throne of heaven and prays for us, prays that we would know the saving work that he came to provide. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Does anybody know where this picture was taken this week? Does anybody know? Over in the side here. Does anybody know? You're going to have to shout out. It was in Baltimore, yes. Where the container ship hit the bridge, having lost power. We live in a world where things break, where things are fragile, where things don't last, and where we mess up. And so what would we want to pray for a world that sees things like that and weeps over it? How about this? How about we pray that they would know that because of Easter we have hope, and it's a hope that is, will never perish, will never spoil, will never fade. Shall we pray that? Heavenly Father, we thank you that in a world that breaks, in a world that wears out, in a world where things get spoilt because of our own mistakes, Father, we pray that this Easter our world would know, and particularly those affected by incidents like the Baltimore Bridge, pray that they would know that because of Easter there is a living hope that brings that which will never spoil or perish or fade. We thank you that we have a future hope, and we pray that our world that lives with so much decay would know that. Amen. Here's a picture that will be more familiar to you. Not going to ask where that one is. If you don't know, then just look around you. You're sitting in it. But around us here, around this church building, is a huge graveyard. And every week we take services for those who have lost loved ones. We did it last week, and we will take it this week. And in a world that is where death is such a reality, what would we want to pray because of Easter? What would we want to pray? How about this? How about we pray that people would know that it, because of Jesus, death is not the last word, that we have the victory? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we recognize the pain that death brings in our world and the sadness. And we pray for those who have lost loved ones in our community and in our church family. And we pray that this Easter they would know that Jesus has won the victory over death. That death did not win. It was defeated. That the grave is empty. And that Jesus reigns and lives. And because he lives, we may live too as we trust in him. Amen. And one last one. Who's been doing the Lego trail this week? Who's been doing the Lego trail? Who managed to find all the Lego men? Well done. Who managed to get there yesterday to receive your prize? Did you get your prize yesterday? If you didn't, I'm sure Katie could rustle one up. There's some at the back here. All the way through this week, we have been telling people the good news of Easter. What is it that we want to pray for our community here as we tell them the good news of Easter? How about this? That it, How about that we tell them that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, the new has come. Wouldn't it be great that our community here knows that there is life eternal, a new creation available to them because Jesus is alive. Shall we pray for that? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy that we've had this week of celebrating the good news of Easter as we've done the Easter Trail and many other things. We pray that our community here in Leyland would know that you came to bring a new creation, a new life, life eternal, and that that is possible because of Easter Day. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, these are the wonderful things that we want to pray for our friends, our family, for the world in which we live because of Easter. Shall we stand and sing and celebrate those things together?
One day when sin was as black as could be,
Do please take a seat. It's just such a joy to have the children in with us all the way through the service on Easter Day, which is exactly as it should be, as we gather together as the people of God on this day of all days. We're going to meet now for a moment around the Lord's table to remind ourselves that that Jesus did come to take our sins far away, and that it was in his resurrection that we are justified freely forever into all eternity. And we want our children to share in this moment with us. This is a meal that is for all Christians. If you're here and you're visiting and you're not sure whether you believe and trust in the Lord Jesus for yourself, we don't want you to feel excluded at all at this point. But this meal is for Christians. And if you want to come and, rather than take bread and wine, receive a prayer, then we would love to do that with you. Just please do come to the front when you're guided, and keep your hands by your side, and someone will be delighted to pray with you. If you're a Christian parent of children, and you would like your children to come and join you at the front, then that would be wonderful. We would ask that if children do come to the front, then they come with their parents, and we would ask parents simply to do one of two things. If they would like their children to receive bread and wine, then they can indicate to the person giving that, and then take from the person, and then the parent give to their children. That's one option. The other option, if you don't feel that your children are ready to receive bread and wine for themselves, then simply ask for one of these little cards. These little cards contain a promise. They remind us of our risen Saviour, and they contain these words on the back. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. That is a promise for every Christian. It's a promise that we want to remind our children of, that if we trust in our Saviour, in the death of our Saviour, then we will live with him. So, by all means, bring your children with you. Just indicate to the person who is giving out the bread and wine whether you would like your children to receive the bread and wine, which they're welcome to do as long as you give it to them, or to receive a promise card. Let's take a moment to be quiet as we come and remind ourselves of our need of the Lord Jesus to take away our sin, and then to justify us freely forever. Would you join with me in the words on the screen? Almighty God, you have raised Jesus from the grave and crowned him Lord of all. We confess that we have not bowed before him or acknowledged his rule in our lives. We have gone along with the way of the world and failed to give him glory. Forgive us and raise us from sin, that we may be your faithful people, obeying the commands of our Lord Jesus Christ, who rules the world and is head of the church, his body. Amen. And Scripture tells us that if you declare with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Lord of all life, you are the God of love and do wonderful things. You created the universe where all living things reflect your glory. You give us this great and beautiful earth to discover and to cherish. You give us the sun and moon and the starlit sky. Everything that gives us light, light for our eyes and hearts and minds. You give us your love even when things go wrong. Jesus knew hurt and pain. Through him, you wipe away our tears and fill us with your peace. You give us happy times and things to celebrate. In these, we taste your kingdom, a feast for all your children. You made us all, each wonderfully different, to join with the angels and sing your praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We thank you, loving Father, because you sent Jesus, your Son. He gave his life for us on the cross and showed us the way to live. On the night before he died, when darkness had fallen, Jesus took bread. He gave you thanks and broke it and shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After they had eaten, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks and shared it with his disciples, saying, "This is my blood poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." Help us, Father, to love one another and to work for that day when suffering is ended and all creation is gathered in your loving arms. And now, with all your holy people, we give you glory through Jesus Christ. In the strength of the Spirit, today and forever. Amen. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. With those who are assisting, come forward.
poured out to death. Many times I've wondered at your gift of life, and I'm in that place once again. I'm in that place once again. And once again I look upon the cross where you died. I'm humbled by your mercy and I'm broken inside. Once again I thank you. Once again I pour out my life. Now you are exalted to the highest place, King of the heaven, where one day I'll bow. But for now, I marvel at this saving grace, and I'm full of praise once again.
Shall we stand and declare the glory of our risen Lord? Please take a seat. We hope you'll stay behind afterwards to join us for a cup of tea or coffee. Particularly if you're visiting, we'd love to get to know you a little. We're back here at 6:30. We've got a wonderful evening of Easter praise lined up as we celebrate this day. Coming to church once on Easter Day isn't enough, really, is it? So we'd love to see you back for Easter praise this evening. We'll delight in that. We recognise that the claims of Easter Day are huge. And it's right that they're huge because they are life-changing. The claims of Easter Day, what it is based on, the fact of the resurrection, is extraordinary. It's something that has only ever happened once in history. And it changes the whole world. Now, if that has left you with questions this morning, then we would love to give you an opportunity to chat those through. You can do that with anyone that you came with or with Paul or myself. There's also a little course that we're going to be running starting on April the 18th. It's a Thursday evening called Christianity Explored. If you'd like more details about that and how you can go and ask your questions there, then there's these cards, these orange cards that are available at the welcome desk. Love you to pick one up, and it starts on April the 18th. There's many other things that are going on through the life of our church every week. This week, I think the running club is starting back up. There's a Saturday strollers. There's a walking party going off on Saturday as well. Loads of things to get involved with, to meet other people, and to share and to hear more of the good news of our risen Saviour. Shall I pray for us as we close? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the joy of this day. We thank you that you have given us, in your great mercy, new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And we pray that as we go to celebrate that hope, to investigate that hope, and to share that hope, we pray that you will be with us this day and into all eternity. In the name of our risen Lord, amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Happy Easter.